Listening Library presents Mr. Chickee's Funny Money by Christopher Paul Curtis. Read for you by Joe Holt. Chapter 1. A Bad Ending to a Good Summer. Stephen sat on the banks of the Flint River below the Kersley Dam crying. Not just little splishy splashy tears either. His tears were gushy waterfalls coming out of his eyes. He was crying so hard that the tears weren't just running down his cheeks. They were running over his forehead, into his hair, and sideways into his ears. But who could blame him? Even though he was 9 1/3 years old and probably a genius, he was boo-hooing like a kindergarten baby because he'd just seen the most horrible thing any kid could ever see. Well, almost. His best friend for this week, his greatest pal ever, the only one he'd ever shared all his secrets with, was gone. Not gone for the weekend, or to a new neighborhood, or to a new town, or even out of the country. He was gone forever. Stephen kept his eyes on the churning and boiling and splashing water at the base of the dam, but deep down inside him, he knew. No one, no matter how big and strong they were, could fall over that dam and hold their breath for 15 minutes, and that was how long it had been. Gone. That one word kept coming into Stephen's mind. It stopped that other word, that other four-letter word. He didn't want to think of both that other four-letter word that began and ended with D and his best friend in the same sentence. For the first few minutes after he'd dragged himself out of the water, Stephen had stared at the spot where they had landed. He kept saying, "Come on, come on, where are you?" He'd always believed that if you thought about something hard enough and positively enough, you could make it happen. So for 10 minutes, he kept imagining his friend popping to the surface of the water, gasping and gulping in huge lungfuls of precious air before finally swimming over to the riverbank, where Stephen would help pull him out. After he had imagined this over and over and over, and after no head came to the surface, Stephen knew. He knew he'd been very lucky in the 250-foot fall over the dam. His friend had not. Stephen sat on the riverbank in shock. A pretty good-sized puddle that mixed Flint River water and tears was growing around him, but he didn't care. He didn't even put his face in his hands. He just stuck his face out and cried. Crashing down the bank toward him through a jungle of thrown-out refrigerators and TVs and plastic garbage bags and weeds were 6 men all dressed in black suits with white shirts and red neckties. One of them yelled, "Over here! The little boy's alive! He's down here!" All 6 men held objects that looked like teeny-weeny satellite dishes. All 6 dishes were going beep, 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 and flashing green and blue lights. The man who had spotted Stephen pointed his dish and it beeped faster and faster as he got nearer. Stephen didn't even care. His friend had only been gone for a few minutes, and already Stephen felt so bad and lonely and sad that nothing seemed important. The man crouched beside him and said, "There, there, son. It's going to be all right." Stephen felt like he was dreaming when the man took off his black suit jacket and wrapped it around his shoulders. "I'll call an ambulance. You've got a pretty nasty bump on your head there, and we don't want to take any chances." It didn't even seem strange when the man started talking into his watch. "Come in, base, Agent 1 here. I've got an injury at the bottom of the dam. Subject A3 has suffered a possible concussion and appears to be disoriented. Request an ambulance at—" The man looked at his little satellite dish. "At coordinates 9-0-3, Tristar, 3-8-7, Ooga Booga, 3-3-3-4, over." The watch answered the man. "1, is A3 in possession of the item? Does he still have it?" Agent 1 pointed his mini-dish at Stephen. It went, beep, beep, beep. One answered, "I'm afraid not, Base. That's a negative." The watch said, "Oh no, this is terrible. He must have lost it in the fall over the dam. Is A3 alert enough to be questioned?" Agent 1 gently shook Stephen and said, "Son? Son, are you okay?" What kind of question was that? How could someone be okay when they knew their best friend was gone? Stephen just looked at the man. "Now, son," Agent 1 said, "you've got to help us out here. Things will be a lot easier if you cooperate, all right?" Stephen nodded. not because he agreed, but because he knew that was what the man wanted him to do. Okay, good boy. Now, where is it? We're pretty sure you had it when you two started running across the top of the dam. Did you drop it in the water? Do you know which side it fell on? Just tell me where it is and maybe I can help you out and you won't have to go to jail for too long. Stephen had to think about this. He wished his head would stop spinning for a second so he could make the kind of decision a good detective would about what he should do next. One thing he did know, spinning head or not, was that this man didn't really care about helping him. He was trying to scare him with that talk about jail, and it worked. Stephen started wondering what bad thing could happen next. Look, kid, tell me where it is, or things could get pretty bad for you. The man's tone changed. He... Stephen pointed at the spot where they'd landed in the water. He must still have it. I think he swallowed it while we were falling. One aimed his mini-dish at the spot where Stephen pointed. The dish went, boo-weep, boo-weep, boo-weep. One yelled into his watch, base, base. Subject B1 allegedly still has the item in his possession. I'm getting a positive reading on my parabolic unit indicating the item is underwater at the foot of the dam. Stephen knew what that meant and started getting dizzy all over again. He put his hand on his forehead and felt a lump the size of a ping-pong ball. It was then that the other four-letter word finally came to him. He knew he had to say it. Dead, Stephen mumbled. He's dead. The agent said, well, if he isn't, he's doing a pretty good imitation of it. Stephen sat down, so shook up that he felt like he was half passed out, half passed in. The five other men in black suits found him and Agent One and talked into their watches while they pointed their mini-dishes at the water. Yes, sir, Agent Fondue, we've almost got it. Negative base, no sign other than parabolic indication. That's correct.
Bweep, bweep, bweep.
Ambulance en route for the little pain in the neck. City officials have been contacted. Affirmative. Dam will be shut off in 12 hours. Body of B1 and the item will be recovered.
Bweep, bweep, bweep.
Stephen's head spun and spun, but he kept asking himself how this had happened. How had this terrible nightmare started? It started with Mr. Othello Chickee, a good friend who had given Stephen a very strange gift. As he heard the scream of a siren coming nearer and nearer, Stephen forced himself to remember it all. He searched his mind to see if he could have stopped this from happening or done something different and changed this horrible ending to his summer with his best friend tangled up in the weeds at the bottom of a dam and him about to go to prison. As the men put Stephen on a stretcher and started pulling him up the riverbank, he remembered exactly how this nightmare had started. Chapter 2. Mr. Chickee's Gift. Stephen knew that Mr. Chickee liked him better than the rest of the kids in the neighborhood. It wasn't just that Stephen's dad and Mr. Chickee were friends, either. Mr. Chickee knew everybody and was friends with all the adults on Flint's south side. But of all the boys around 8 or 9 or 10 years old, Stephen was the only one who always gave Mr. Chickee the proper respect and didn't treat him like there was something wrong with him. Stephen looked at Mr. Chickee with an open mind, which is the way a detective has to look at everything. When the other kids would tell fantastic stories and tall tales about Mr. Chickee and his being blind, Stephen would twist up his face and try to ignore them or try to set them straight. Andre Warrington had said that Mr. Chickee wasn't blind at all, that he was really a secret agent hired by the government to spy on people in the neighborhood. If that's true, Stephen had said, where does he keep his badge, his gun, and his walkie-talkie? Have you ever seen a secret agent without those? That was enough to make Andre Warrington quit talking nonsense. Smudge Monday had said that his mother had told him that Mr. Chickee used to be a jet fighter pilot during the Civil War, and that he'd gone blind when he flew too close to the sun while chasing a UFO and took his sunglasses off to get a better look. Stephen had shut Smudge up, too, when he asked, if that's true, how did he land his plane without blowing it up and killing himself? And if he was blind, why didn't the aliens beam themselves onto his plane and steal all the top secret information? Smudge had given Stephen a look that went from being confused to being dirty. Daniel Love had said that Mr. Chickee's white cane had super secret, sneaky, scientific stuff in it that warned Mr. Chickee when a car was coming, or who was walking toward him, or where a telephone pole was. Stephen had said, "If that's true, where are the batteries or the extension cord to run?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.